Well, it's a fine distinction. Mostly preternatural deals with the particular kind of state of affairs that occurred before the fall of man.
Oh.
And so we had a natural existence, but not of the same kind of nature that we fallen nature that we have today.
Yep.
And so that's where the preternatural gifts we have are confined to a discussion of the
Adam and Eve,
or what is also called pre-lapsarian. Being before the fall.
Lapse. Yeah.
Before the lapse, yes.
You know, I do think you're very good at defending the Catholic faith, explaining it and defending it.
I try.
But I feel like we should do an hour sometime where you give other people tips for defending the faith. Like, when you're confronted with a question like this, here's how you might consider responding. Mm. Or when you have this challenge in your conversation with somebody about the faith, here's how you might handle that situation. So, what do you think about doing that?
I would enjoy doing that today. I love being able to equip people.
Good.
You might be having, hey, I'm wanting to talk about this subject, but how do I broach this with another person? A lot of my shows, we will have people who call who are not Catholic. And I enjoy that, both on this show and on my podcast, The Council of Trent, at trenthornpodcast.com. We've had atheists, we've had people who are pro-choice, we've got other people scheduled in coming months who are pro-LGBT, who I'm hoping to actually have a Satanist come on around Halloween. So that'll be an interesting show.
Why around Halloween?
I don't know. It's apropos.
I guess so. It is apropos.
You know, spooky. And we need to talk. You know, we have to talk to everybody, no matter where they may fall on the theological spectrum. We are called to share Christ with them.
Thank you for saying that, Trent.
And so for you, when you want to share the faith, the gospel, talk about the church's moral teachings with others, if you hit roadblocks or you have questions about that, I'm happy to give you a little quarterbacking, or I could either be quarterbacking,
coaching, yeah,
or depends. It could be football, or maybe I could be like Mickey in Rocky. If someone says, "Oh, I had a hard time with this conversation, I can't go back and talk to that guy," I'll say, "Get up, you bum."
I see where your heart is on that one.
I can't be Mickey.
I see where you want. You're just trying to be encouraging to people,
right?
But say someone's, in their parish or their family, they're trying to be a good explainer and defender of the faith. I don't know that they would experience that as encouraging.
Then I try someone else to say, get out there and win one for the tripper, the hipper. You know, win one for the gipper. So get out there and. I'm trying to encourage people.
888-318-7884 is the number. 888-318-7884. If you would like some tips on defending the faith, this is your hour. Trent Horn is here. Want to hear something?
Yes.
About the Gipper?
Yes.
My grandfather went to college with him.
Really?
He knew George Gipp.
I did not know that.
Yeah. So it offends me.
Does that offend you?
No, I don't know. It's just like in the culture today, you're supposed to take offense at everything. So now it offends me that you made a joke about George Gipp.
That's called outrage culture.
Outrage culture.
And one of these, they need to do a modern parallel, like the boy who cried wolf.
Yeah.
We need to do one, the boy who cried offended. People like, oh, you're not really offended. Oh, you're making up. Oh, you're making up. Then finally someone really offends him and nobody believes and he gets eaten by wolves.
That would, what a great story.
Chad. I don't know. Right. I don't know.
You're a media genius, really.
I'll be. My sarcasm detector is going through the roof. Oh, a sarcasm detector. How useful.
If I asked you right now to give the number, could you do it? Let's see if you could do it. Don't look over there.
No, I'm not going to
look. Don't look over there.
I'm looking right at you, Si.
If
you want to call 888.
Yep.
888. Pound sign.
No.
No, 888-7. No. 888-318. 7884.
Woo!
Okay.
Trent Horn.
Pound sign, hashtag Bitcoin.
No, there's no pound signs or hashtags.
Hashtag. Hashtag Si Kelly.
We want your calls. If you would like some help defending the faith, that is what Trent Horn is here to do. If you'd like some help explaining the faith, tips for defending the faith is our topic this hour. 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. Here, I'm going to share a situation that actually happened to me, and I want you to tell me how you would have handled it, because I am 100% sure I didn't handle it right. No, I'm not 100% sure. I don't know if there was a right way to handle this situation in defending the Catholic faith. I'm on a Catholic Answers cruise, okay? My wife and I get on an elevator in the Catholic Answers cruise. That means there's Catholic Answers people all over this cruise.
Right.
This guy gets on and he goes, and now the elevator has like six floors to go down. Okay. And he goes, I've seen all you Catholics all over the cruise. What are you doing? And I said, we're having a conference about explaining and defending the Catholic faith. Basically, that's what we were doing.
Yes.
And he goes, I was in South America and I was really disappointed in the Catholics down there. I really have to say I lost a lot of respect. And I don't think he did actually lose respect. I think he's one of those people that never had respect and likes to say that he lost respect. But anyways, that's just, I lost a lot of respect for you because there's poor people everywhere down there. And you have these big churches full of gold and poor people everywhere. What is the church doing for the poor? Okay, it seems like I'm a Catholic and I'm at a Catholic apologetics conference. I should be able to answer that. Now, admit that we're getting to the bottom now. The doors are about to open. How do I respond to that? And this is what I came up with.
Okay.
I said, well, all of those churches are for the poor. They're always open to the poor. I wonder if the other rich people in South America open their houses for the poor. And then the guy left. And I was like, that felt more like slapping the guy than actually answering.
I understand where you're coming from. And I think you wanted to diffuse the point that the church does not care about the poor. And sometimes we are tempted to want to counter with the same force that we have received.
That's what I did, I think. That's what I did.
So I think you were on the right track to say, well, these churches, they're not built for princes to live in. They're for people to worship, and anyone can go in. And what's most important is what they give the poor is not just a place to worship, but the ability to receive the person they're worshiping. And they can receive the bread of life that gives eternal life. Isn't that the most important thing we could be giving people? And they're like, well, yes or no. But then we always want to leave people, not so much, I beat you, but with something for them to think about that's profound. That's always our goal in our conversations. You always want to leave them wanting more. That was just from my background in sales.
I don't think
that this is sales.
I don't think I left this man wanting more at all.
That's what we don't want to do in our car. And that's why it's hard. We live in an age, a Twitter age, a social media age, where we want to just win. And that's not the goal. We don't want to, the venerable Fulton Sheen, was it blessed now? No, it's venerable.
Not blessed yet.
No, it's venerable. Yeah, right. The venerable Fulton Sheen once said that you could win an argument and lose a soul.
Yeah,
we don't want to.
I think I lost both.
You can never. You never know. But maybe
I lost both on that day.
But you never know. Yeah. Maybe it's something that he needed to hear in that moment. He's like, maybe I'm being unfair towards the church. You never know. But at the very least, we just always learn from our interactions and try to get better at them.
I remember Hemingway said the worst kind of failure is one that's both a moral and a practical failure at once. That's what this felt like. Combination moral and practical failure.
Here's the question. I've often said it's okay to make mistakes. It's just not okay to refuse to learn from them.
All right.
That's the thing. All right. We will all make mistakes. We cannot treat evangelism like trying to keep our baseball average up. It's not like, hey, I'm batting 300. I'm batting 330. You know, I don't want this to go down, so I'm going to sit out a few games.
Yeah.
We don't want to make it so, hey, I've had these great interactions. I'm not going to risk having a bad one. That's not what God is calling us to. God does not call the equipped. He equips the called. And part of the way he equips us is he just has us go out there to share the faith and learn from each of our interactions. And as long as we're willing to learn and be corrected and be humble, then we're still going to be doing the Lord's will. We're not doing his will if we, out of pride, don't want to talk to people because we're worried about looking dumb or embarrassing ourselves.
Yeah.
And at the very least, even if you don't know what to say, you don't need to have the right answers. You can just ask people questions. Why do you think that? How do you think that's relevant to what the church teaches? What would make you reconsider the Catholic faith? What's the ideal way the Catholic faith ought to be lived out?
Yeah.
And would you want to be a part of that if it were authentic? Going down that route.
888-318-7884 is the number. Hey, the on-the-go half-price digital sale, it ends at midnight tonight. So you get 50% off all ebooks, e-magazines, MP3s, including Trent's newest book, Counterfeit Christ, and all his other great books in their ebook or MP3 format. Visit shop.catholic.com, take advantage of the great deals, but you got to do so before midnight tonight, and that's Hawaii time, by the way. Midnight Hawaii time. You can still get those deals. Lots of calls for Trent. Tips for defending your faith right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
This is Archbishop Salvatore Cordiglione of San Francisco. Thank you for listening to Catholic Answers Live.
The leading Catholic voices are on EWTN Radio.
I've got a few things here and there that I've learned along the way. I'm always studying history, and I love studying history. So I try to bring in some of the historical perspective, especially at a time in our history when people don't know much history anymore.
Open Line with Father Mitch Pacwa, tonight, 10 Eastern, on EWTN Radio.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite monks of Wyoming. Delicious mystic monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All mystic monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase mystic monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live, Tips for Defending the Faith with Trent Horn this hour. I just was alerted to the fact that there's a small error on our Facebook stream, and it says this hour is Carlo and next hour is Carlo as well. So anybody who's badly disappointed that Trent is here this hour, I'm sorry, it's just a mistake. We'll all get... Why are you looking at me like that,
Trent? I will do my best to fill in for Mr. Carlo. Man, I'll do my best.
You can't do a Cajun accent. No,
I know I can't. I can't do any accents. I am routinely criticized for...
I thought you could do accents.
No, I try to do accents. I think I could do impersonations decently enough of people, but accents, I'm always corrected on them.
Yeah. You don't want to get accents wrong, because then people's feelings get hurt.
It's true. Yeah, you don't want to belittle an entire region or country or group of people.
And if I try to do accents, it almost always sounds like William Wallace talking, some archaic Scottish something. I don't know why, but that's my default.
They may take our lives, but they'll never take our Catholic radio.
See, now that sounded Irish to me. We better go to calls. 888-318-7884. I don't think I should have as much fun as I do when you're on. I think it kind of ruins the show when I'm having that much fun. Trevor, in Minnesota, you are up first today. Your question for Trent Horn.
Freedom!
See, he appreciated it. Thank you, Trevor.
Thank you, Trevor. I hope that wasn't supposed to be like a Spanish accent or something.
No, that was just my William Wallace tribute.
All right.
So how can we help you, Trevor?
I do have a question, though.
Sure.
Okay. What do you do if, and I've had this happen quite a few times, especially with the younger generation, when you start sharing the faith and whatnot, and they go, well, the Bible's irrelevant. I don't believe in the Bible. I have my own Bible. And they won't even listen to you twice because the Bible is not a relevant book to them anymore.
Well, I guess I might ask them a question. Why isn't the Bible relevant? What do you see as something that you can't learn from it? And what do you mean by your own Bible? Like, is it because the Bible was written a long time ago? Is it because it contains stories of miracles? I would first want to get to the root and say, what is it that you think makes the Bible irrelevant to your life? Well, I don't know what you think they would answer to that.
Okay.
Well, let's just start right there. Why don't you could pick one. I mean, we could just take one, for example. It might say, well, it was written a long time ago. But that doesn't mean that it's irrelevant. There's lots of things that were written a long time ago that still matter for us. The works of ancient Greek philosophers that talk about the virtue of democracy or of sound governing in political structures or of how to lead a ethical, fulfilling life were written thousands of years ago. And yet they're still relevant to us today. Like Aristotle talked about how when we're trying to choose to do good, we should always strive for the golden mean. You know, sometimes with our virtues, you know, with courage, that's always the golden middle ground between being cowardly and being foolhardy and charging into danger without caring. So, you know, there's something written 2,500 years ago that still matters today. Why wouldn't you give that same deference to the Bible and what it teaches? I might also ask them, what do you think the Bible teaches and why is that not relevant? Then finally, I might ask them, do you think the Bible is not true 100%? So do you think there was no ancient Jerusalem, there's no Pontius Pilate, there was no Jesus, no first Christians? Why do you think that that's the case? Do you deny all of ancient history then? That seems kind of anti-intellectual to do that? Or instead, what's the most basic things out of the Bible you can agree with? So I might try to find common ground with them. Could you agree in Leviticus 19? The book of Leviticus and talks about love your neighbor as yourself. You know, Jesus taught the golden rule, but he was quoting Leviticus. You know, finding things in the Proverbs and Psalms people agree with ethically. Do you agree there was at least a Jesus and he was crucified? Who do you think Jesus was? So I might try to start with a very kind of minimal facts approach. Is that helpful, Trevor?
Oh, yeah. I like them ideas.
All right.
Trevor, thanks for the William Wallace intro, and thanks for the call. Appreciate it. Let's go to Mark in Tennessee, listening to Channel 130 Sirius Satellite Radio. That's EWTN on Sirius Satellite Radio. Mark, your question for Trent Horn.
Hey, guys. How's it going?
Very well, Mark.
You there?
We're here.
We are.
Okay. Well, listen, I don't have so much a question. I have kind of maybe a suggestion or a possible answer to what the question that was posed to you on that cruise, because I get that a lot as a Catholic, you know, the idea of, you know, got, you know, all these churches that have all this money, why don't you just sell them and then just give it all to the poor? Mm-hmm. And so the analogy that I've tried to make in the past is, it's like saying, you know, you've got a university that's got a lot of money, and you've got all these people without educations, and you're telling them, come to our university, and you know you'll be able to get an education that will give you more money. And that's like saying, well, why don't you just sell off all the land and all the equipment and just give it to the people so they'll have the money, you know, for the rest of their lives.
Right. Yeah, and I think Mark, when this objection is raised, I think it's important to point out to people, one, where they're being inconsistent, that it sounds like they're not motivated out of concern for the poor as much as they're trying to find some way to undermine the Catholic Church. I might say to them, you know, do you think that everyone with means should do the same thing? It seems like they want Catholics to just worship in trailers, basically, or portable housing units and sell these churches and sell these great works of art and then give that money to the poor. I might say, well, what's the trade-off involved in that? First, as I said, it's inconsistent. Nobody asks that, you're right, Harvard sell their buildings and just have everybody in trailers. What about the Smithsonian and these magnificent museums? Why don't we just have these works of art in very cheap buildings to put them in? And I think people will see, well, no, that there's also having a fitting place to have these kinds of treasures so that people can go and see them. The other point I would bring up is that what the church has, it's not something the church owns, but it's really more on loan. It's something that people, when it comes to buildings or tapestry or works of art, these are gifts to the church that were meant to be something that all Christians could share and be able to pass on. So to sell them to like to a private collector would actually be a very selfish thing to do. It'd be like if your grandfather gave you his watch as a memorabilia, and it's a sign of, you know, it's his great-grandfather gave it to him, and it's been in your family for generations with the intention that you're going to give it to your children as a sign of the faithfulness of your family and how you've worked hard to sacrifice, and then you just turned around, went and sold it, and gave the money to the poor. I mean, good to give the money to the poor, but you would have kind of dishonored the intention of your ancestors in trying to pass on this gift to future generations. And I think that's the same thing we can bring up with the church's art and its property. Another point I would bring up is that the reason that we have churches is not just to go and worship. We want to have places where people can lift their hearts up to God. You could bring up that when Jesus was tempted by the devil, Jesus responded, you know, the devil asked Jesus, why don't you just turn this stone into bread? And Jesus said, well, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. So the church, I would ask this person, what do you think the church's primary goal is here on earth? The primary goal. What are we called to do? Our goal is to get people to heaven. Now, part of the way you get people to heaven is you share the gospel with them, and people can't focus on the gospel if they're starving to death. So obviously you have to feed people bread before you can give them spiritual bread. But at the same time, if you only focus on the literal earthly bread and neglect the spiritual bread, they're only temporarily better off. They still may have an eternity apart from God, and they're not benefited. So I think when people make this objection, they are confusing what what the church does. And you should ask them, do you think it's important to have fitting places of worship where people can come to a knowledge of God, even in the architecture and art? Is that not worth it to have all that for someone to have eternal life? That might be another point I would bring up. Is that helpful?
Oh, absolutely. Those are all great points. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Mark. Thank you very much for your tip, too. Do you ever have that feeling? I wish I could just get back in that elevator.
There will always be cases where we need to provide elevator speeches. I actually covered this in my podcast a few months ago.
Oh, yeah?
Where you're waiting in line. You're at the coffee shop. You know you only have 30 seconds with someone.
Yeah.
And they ask you a question. You have to give a soundbite answer. So I call that an elevator speech. What would you give while you're in that elevator, that short, limited time window you have with someone? So you want to make it memorable and inviting for them to want to learn more. Yeah. I think that's the idea. Like, if this came up, my elevator speech, why doesn't the church sell what it has to give to the poor? I might ask, well, what is the most important thing the church could give the poor? The most absolute important thing it should give the poor. I think it should give them Jesus Christ, just like the most important thing it can give any of us. Now, what's the best way for the church to be able to do that?
Yeah, but what you're not getting is the better your answer gets on this, the worse I feel about what I actually said. That's where I am, right? But sorry, that's a really good point. Like what you just said, I agree.
Well, it's easy for me to do retrospection. Yeah. Retrospective hindsight is 20/20.
Yeah.
But the thing is, I've talked to people and I've had foot and mouth disease often. And the point is we all have to learn and be willing to learn from where conversations didn't go as well to how we can make them be better. But I think honestly, asking questions in reply when you have a limited amount of time makes the person think about it more than just giving a stock answer. I think
that's
helpful.
That's a very good tip. And that's what we're doing, tips for defending the faith with Trent Horn this hour. Margaret in Wilmington, North Carolina, listening on 91.3 FM. You are up next. Margaret, your question for Trent.
Hi. How you doing, Trent? Thanks for taking my call.
Sure.
Trent, my question is, what would your rebuttal be to somebody who says, oh, you're one of them. You Catholics make everybody feel guilty about everything.
Once again, questions. I might ask, how do Catholics make people feel guilty? And then, I don't know, what do you think they would say?
People feel guilty about everything.
How do we do that? I know it sounds like a dumb question. But the point is, you guys are saying that it's wrong to have abortions or use contraception, and that makes people feel guilty. Or, you know, you say these certain things are sins, that makes people feel guilty. Then I might ask a more startling question. Is that bad? Is it bad for people to feel guilty? I might ask them, when do you think it's good for us to feel guilty about something? I'd say, well, it's good to feel guilty if you've done something wrong, because it motivates you to turn your life around and apologize and do things right. Do you think if we do something wrong, we should feel guilty and we should change our lives? And then you get the conversation away from, you guys make people feel guilty, to, they shouldn't feel wrong, they're not doing anything wrong. And then you can have a more substantive conversation about, is this moral behavior, is it right or is it wrong? Because if it's wrong, we ought not do it because it destroys our relationship with God if it's morally grave. That might be the approach I might take in these situations. Once again, asking questions to make the person reconsider the assumptions that drive their argument. Is that helpful for you?
Me, yes, it sure does. To me, it's common sense. The answer would be common sense. But for her to make a remark like that, and it's not the first time either, to make a remark like that about that she's Protestant.
Oh, okay.
And I don't know if it's an attack on my faith or...
Well, I guess what I might say to her is, now, if she's coming from a Protestant perspective, she may think that because our sins are forgiven, we do not have to feel guilty about them anymore. And that's simply not the case. When you read in the writings of St. Paul, for example, in Romans chapter 7, he talks about the war in his members, and he feels bad. He feels a guilt about how he desires to do things that he knows are wrong. It's certainly, even in the Christian life, even if you're quote unquote saved from the Protestant perspective, we still do things where we fall short. And so we should feel guilt for when we transgress God's law and seek forgiveness. That's why in the Our Father, we pray every day, Father, forgive us for our trespasses. So I would say that the Catholic faith has a health. People can take guilt to an unhealthy extreme, but it also helps us. Guilt can help us have a correct, proper moral inventory.
Thanks, Margaret. When someone says, "Why do you Catholics make other people feel guilty?" I say, "That makes me feel guilty when you say that."
There's only one. Catholic Answers Live.
Jesus asked his disciples, "Who do you say that I am?" Turns out that today, as back then, this question has a lot of different answers. So many groups want to appropriate Jesus, tweaking his identity until he looks and sounds just like one of them. But then you no longer have the Lord, says apologist Trent Horn. You have an imposter. In his new groundbreaking book, Counterfeit Christ, Trent exposes 18 phony versions of Jesus that we encounter today, helping you to recognize the fakes when you see them, explain why they're phony, and make a case for the full truth and beauty of who Jesus is, the Christ, the Son of the living God. Order your copy of Counterfeit Christ today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Looking for an on-fire Catholic speaker for your event? Catholic Answers speakers will inform and inspire your audience to grow in their Catholic faith. For more information on booking a Catholic Answers speaker, visit CatholicAnswersSpeakers.com today.
Love and beauty. As a little girl, Dawn Eden Goldstein knew that she wanted those things, that in them somehow she would find God. Over the years as a rock journalist, she moved among some of popular music's best-known artists, straining to capture that transcendent love and beauty in every note and lyric. In Sunday Will Never Be the Same, Dawn recounts her spiritual journey in beautifully wrought detail, mixing powerful accounts of trauma, healing, and epiphany with funny anecdotes from inside the music scene. It is the rare conversion story that delights as it inspires, amuses as it edifies, and ultimately lays before the reader a lived testimony to the transforming grace of Christ. Order your copy of Sunday Will Never Be the Same by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
I'm Gloria Purvis.
And I'm Deacon Harold. The Morning Glory team talks about being a public witness of our faith.
Tomorrow morning, 7 Eastern. Now back to Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Tips for defending your faith this hour. If you've got questions about how to answer other people's questions about the faith, or even questions about how to answer other people's challenges to the faith, this would be a good hour for you. 888-318-7884, the number. And our guest is Trent Horn, apologist here at Catholic Answers, author of many things, including his latest book, Counterfeit Christs, which I can highly recommend to you. It's a clever idea. It's about all the different ways Christ is presented in the contemporary world that actually don't have that much to do with the real Christ. And I know you will enjoy that book. You can get that over at shop.catholic.com. Trent also does a podcast. The podcast is called The Council of Trent. You can find it at trenthornpodcast.com, as thousands and thousands of other people do each week. Lots of calls for you, Trent, shall we?
Let's do it.
All right. Let us go then to, I pushed the wrong button. Let's go to Catherine in Michigan, listening on the TuneIn app. Catherine, your question for Trent.
Hello. Thank you so much for this program. This is just awesome that you guys do this.
Oh, thank you, Catherine. No problem.
So one of my best friends is married and in a homosexual relationship. Mm-hmm. He's also a Christian that is honestly seeking after God. And through many different difficult conversations with him, and actually God speaking to him in a dream, he finally told me that he feels like he's being called to become a Catholic.
Mm-hmm.
He said he's keeping an open mind, and he's spoken with priests since then about becoming Catholic, but they, of course, have all told him that he can't join the church while still being married to his husband.
Right.
And I've tried to explain to him the church's stance on marriage, that it's supposed to be faithful and fruitful, and how men and women are complementary to each other, and how it images the Trinity. And he usually doesn't believe my arguments at first when I try to tell him some things, and I'm also not great at debating some of these things. So I don't know if you have books, other resources, and he's, of course, he's done so much research. So he's looked at all of the basic Bible passages that everybody looks at about these. So,
well, Catherine, if I may, I'll just throw this out to you. There, it does seem that you get conflicting stories from different parts of the Catholic Church today on that. Is this something that you have experience of your friend experiencing? Like, yeah, but this priest over here says this, or this Catholic magazine over here says that.
You mean he's getting, are you asking if he is getting conflicting information?
Yes.
No, he's not getting conflicting information.
Okay.
Not that I know of. He's just having a hard time getting over that, okay, I feel like I'm being called to the Catholic Church, but I'm not willing to leave my marriage.
Right. Gotcha. And so I think, Catherine, in these situations, we should always appeal to people's nobility, that no one chooses evil for its own sake. People don't delight in evil. Evil is always an absence or a distortion of good. And so we should validate people when they're trying to choose a good, trying to do good, even if it's in a disordered or evil way. I'm not saying that we should always validate every single behavior or action a person engages in, but we should try to reach people where they're at and help them to see that they desperately want the good, and that's not necessarily bad. So, for example, if this man wants to provide for the well-being of this other man that he deeply cares for, there's nothing contrary in him willing the authentic good for this other person. Part of that authentic good would just not include a sexual relationship. But it's possible, if he's in a mature relationship and mature in his faith life, it could possibly include chaste common life with each other. If he is mature and able to be in that situation without presenting unnecessarily stumbling blocks for himself that could lead to sexual sin. A good documentary I might recommend to him that you could share with him, say, you know, well, first to validate, you're seeking after God, and it sounds like God, if it's the case, has appeared to you, he's seeking after you, he's seeking after all of us. But you realize this, that if God is real and he desires a relationship with you, he calls us to give up so much to follow him. The first Christians gave up their families, their friends, who were thrown out of the synagogue. Some of them were burned on crosses, or they were thrown to lions in Colosseums. All Christians make a sacrifice and carry a cross in following God. And those who have same-sex attractions or in same-sex relationships have their own crosses to bear and sacrifices to make. So a documentary I might share with him, Catherine, is called Desire of the Everlasting Hills. It's produced by Courage, which is an apostolate within the Catholic Church dedicated to helping people with same-sex attraction live chaste lives. It's called, you can just Google it. You can watch it for free online. In fact, if you give our call screen or your email, I'll email it to you. Desire of the Everlasting Hills. It's a documentary about three people, two men and one woman, who have same-sex attractions and left the Catholic faith, but later returned to it. And in fact, one of the men in the documentary was in a same-sex romantic relationship. He broke off the romantic part after returning to the church, but still shares a common life with this other person. And so I think that you can help him see that what the church is asking is not for him to engage in enmity or malice towards others, especially this person he's married to, but calling him and those he loves to goodness, to authentic goodness. So part of that would be showing what he's called to, which is hard, but not unreasonable. And then also showing the beauty of the teaching of our Catholic faith. So a few resources on that, and I'll email it to you. So give our call screen your email. Father Mike Schmitz has a wonderful book on this called Made for Love. And Daniel Mattson has a book, Why I Don't Call Myself Gay. He has same-sex attraction, but chooses to live a chaste life. Those might be other resources. So I would recommend appealing to nobility, validate his desire to do good, to follow God, to wherever it may lead, and to say, would you agree if we follow God, we all have to make sacrifices, sometimes very large ones. But in the end, shouldn't we pick God above all these other things? And that might be the approach I would take. Is that helpful?
Yeah, thank you very much. Hopefully some of these resources will be helpful to him and I can nudge him towards them. This is going to be a slow process, but God is definitely in it.
Yeah, well, he sure is.
He is. So I'll email that to you and I'll include a copy of my book, Why We're Catholic, which may also be helpful for him.
Thanks, Catherine. We go now to Renee in Cocoa, Florida, listening on Divine Mercy Radio. Renee, your question for Trent Horn.
Hi, how are you? Thanks for taking my call.
Of course.
My cousin posted a picture of Pope Francis on Facebook, and the wording around it said something to the effect, "This man cannot forgive your sins. Only Jesus Christ can do that." Mm-hmm. And, you know, just a way to respond to her. I come from a long line of Baptists,
sure.
But I've been Catholic most of my life. So just a way to respond that won't turn her off.
You could say, "We totally agree. Completely agree." I completely agree with you. And you could even quote what the church teaches on that. You can quote paragraph 1441 of the Catechism. That's 1441, so 1441. This is what the church teaches. It says, "Only God forgives sins. Since he is the Son of God, Jesus says of himself, the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins and exercises this divine power. Your sins are forgiven." That's a reference to Mark 2:5. "Further, by virtue of his divine authority, he gives this power to men to exercise in his name." So you can say that, of course, human beings cannot forgive sin, but we can achieve the forgiveness of sin by acting on Christ's authority. For example, if your family's Baptist, so Baptists believe different things about this. Do they believe that baptism is just a way to show people you're Christian, or do they think that baptism really takes away sin?
I would think, I would feel they probably just said it just makes you Christian.
It just shows you're Christian. It doesn't make you anything.
Right.
Yeah. Well, to make an analogy, that Protestants who believe in baptismal regeneration, at the very least, or they know Protestants who believe this, they're not that far removed from them, not like Catholics. The Protestants who believe that baptism actually takes away sin, which is what the Bible teaches, look at Acts 2:38, 1 Peter 3:21, John 3:5, that when you are baptized, it is not the pastor or the minister, the guy pouring the water is not the person who takes away your original sin. Jesus does that. But the person, that minister, is a means by which for Jesus to do that, much the same way that it is not the priest qua priest. It's not the priest in virtue of being a human being who can forgive sins. He can't forgive diddly. But Christ working through him, when he's in the person of Christ, Christ can choose to use him as a means to have to forgive sins, just like Christ can use the water of baptism to forgive sins and make people Christian. I would point him to, once you bring this forward, that no, only God forgives sins, but he can delegate that authority to human beings. Look in Scripture where he's done that. John 20:23 would be an example of this. Jesus says to the apostles, "Whose sins you forgive are forgiven, whose sins you retain are retained." So right there, what does that mean? He's telling the apostles they can forgive sins on his authority. I would also ask this person to show you where in the New Testament does it say we should confess our sins to the risen Jesus? Doesn't say that. Nowhere in the New Testament.
Footnotes?
Well,
appendices?
Well, any footnotes or appendices are not the inspired word of God.
Okay.
The Bible doesn't say that. It doesn't say that. At best, 1 John 1:9 says, "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and forgives us." But there, the context of confession in 1 John 1:9 is clear. It's not to God. John is talking about when we confess our sins to other people. And public confession was the norm in the early church. So those are two different paths that I would take to agree only God forgives sin, but he can give that authority to other people. John 20:23 is an example of this. And ask, where does the Bible say to pray to Jesus and ask him to forgive our sins? It doesn't say that, actually. Rather, it says in James 5 that if a man is sick and the elders of the church, the priests, come and anoint him, his sins will be forgiven. There's an example of people being involved in the forgiveness of sins. So if you like, just stay on the line, give your email to our call screener. I'll send you a copy of my book, The Case for Catholicism. It has a whole section on confession that has all these resources in it that may be helpful in your conversation. So would that be helpful?
Oh, that's very helpful. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Renee. Thanks very much. Tips for Defending the Faith with Trent Horn this hour on Catholic Answers Live. As I mentioned before, Trent is also the podcaster behind the Council of Trent podcast, which you can find at trenthornpodcast.com. What's your most popular entry you ever had over there?
On trenthornpodcast.com?
Yeah.
Well, I had a conversation with a critic about homosexuality
yeah.
that seems to be of the highest downloads I've had recently. Uh-huh. So it's, the dialogues are very popular on abortion, atheism. We've got other ones coming down the line, and you can check those out, obviously, at trendhornpodcast.com. Although I had one I did, I think like a year ago, I'd have to go back to the statistics to see how it's doing, but it was extremely popular, but no one admitted it was popular.
What do you mean no one admitted it was
popular? Well, I asked people, I put it on social media. The topic was, what are married couples allowed to do sexually?
I remember that one. Yes. It's quite, well, it's PG-13, maybe.
I would say the content is PG-13. Yeah. It's for married couples.
Yeah.
And what's funny was I put it online and it had maybe like 3 likes, no comments. But I checked the download statistics and mm-hmm. it had more, like twice as many as any episode I had done previously.
Uh-huh.
So nobody wanted to say anything about it, but they're all like, well, what are we allowed to do?
Click.
And they wanted to listen. I think that's helpful because people have conflicting advice. And you get this weird... you know how Josh, we'll have to go to break soon, but let me put a bow on this. Josh Harris wrote Kiss Dating Goodbye.
The poor guy. I just read his Instagram post.
It's super
very
sad. Not only did he kiss his marriage goodbye, he's getting a divorce. He kissed Jesus goodbye, kissed the faith goodbye. He's not Christian anymore. And Harris really grew out of that Protestant abstinence movement. And some Catholics adopt this where we just say, well, just don't have sex before marriage. And after marriage, everything's great. You don't have anything to worry about. No, no, no. You have to practice chastity before marriage because you also have to practice chastity after marriage.
Yeah.
And if you don't develop self-control before marriage, you will not, if you don't have self-control in marriage, you're in for a world of hurt for sins like adultery, pornography, contraception, unnatural sexual acts between husband and wife. So it's, you can't just say, oh, as long as you're married, everything's fine. That can lead to very grave moral errors. And so I covered that in my show, talking about what married couples, what's permissible. What's impermissible? And people need to talk about this. It's germane and relevant to many people's lives. And that's what I do on my podcast, is I want to find stuff that's important to you, either sharing the faith or understanding it, and equip you to understand it and explain it to others. And so that's what I do at TrentHornPodcast.com. If you want to learn more, definitely go and check it out.
TrentHornPodcast.com.
Miss a show? Make sure to catch up by downloading the podcast, available online at Catholic.com.
The wisdom of Mother Angelica.
I want you to have such confidence in the Lord that you'll find such hope and see the beauty of the Lord, the majesty of God. What did our Lord say, huh? If your sins are as scarlet, what? What's going to happen? They shall be made white as snow.
EWTN. Live truth. Live Catholic.
We have a big problem. Our culture is dying, and souls are in danger of being lost. The answer is conversion to Jesus Christ in His church. St. Paul Street Evangelization is a Catholic organization, and we have hundreds of teams spreading the good news throughout the country. But we need your help. The harvest is great, but the laborers are few. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Trent Horn, our guest. I have a lot of fun when Trent's here. Next hour, Carlo Broussard's going to be here, and we're going to talk about what comes next, what comes after this life, the last things. Should they be among the first things that we are thinking about? I think Carlo's going to say yes. But we'll also find out from Carlo what actually happens on the other side. There are limits, of course, into how much detail one can go not having been there. But within those limits, Carlo's got a lot to say about that. Hope you'll join us for that second hour. Tips for defending your faith this hour with Trent Horn. And on the line, in calling from Illinois, watching on YouTube Live, is Rebecca. Your question, Rebecca. Hello, Rebecca?
You there, Rebecca?
Oh, really? Wrong line? Which line was I supposed to put?
Rebecca's YouTube Live, and that sounded like a lot of wind for listening to YouTube.
Rebecca, that was my mistake. I pushed the wrong button. Sorry. Rebecca,
normally Cy is great at pushing people's buttons.
Yours, Trent Horn.
Hello, can you hear me?
Hi, Rebecca. Yeah, your question for Trent.
Oh, thank you so much for taking my call. I'm wondering how to respond to random strangers cracked about birth control. I seem to get lots of these kinds of, I don't know if they're trying to be funny or what, but I currently only have one toddler, my husband and I, and it's not as though I'm going to the grocery store with a lot of children, although my mother had to deal with that, and hopefully we'll have a large family. But
so do you? It sounds like you have a little one behind you. How many kids you take that people make cracks?
I thought that was your husband.
I'm sorry for the noise. I only have one right now.
It's
okay. So one kid, you go to the grocery store, and then people who are completely random strangers to you make smart aleck comments about the fact that you have a child.
Not necessarily, but they'll make jokes about birth control, or they'll talk about how certain immoral devices are cheaper than a child, things like that.
Okay, so it
that's
sounds
rude.
Like...
First of all, that's rude.
Yes, it is. And that brings us to a careful line we have to walk in society between being doormats and being jerks. Because we don't want to reply in kind. If someone says something mean to us, we don't want to say something back that's equally mean and sink down to their level. We're better than that. But at the same time, you don't want to be a doormat and let someone get away with being callous or cruel or unjust. They ought to be corrected for their benefit so they can grow as a human being and stop being a rude or insensitive person. So there's different ways you could go about it. Like, and my wife deals with this as well. Ironically, dads don't deal with this as much as moms.
No, it's
nobody
true.
Wants to say this to dads. I think they're worried dads will punch them. Moms are easier targets. For example, I was at Disneyland and with my wife and her sister. And I was ahead of them, and I was pushing two strollers. And as I was pushing the two strollers through Disneyland, I could hear people saying, "Give that dad a medal."
That's what dads get,
yeah,
right?
But if a mom is pushing two strollers, it's like, learn to use birth control. You starting a basketball team, lady? So I mean, it's such a horrible double standard. And so, Rebecca, I feel for you. And what's hard for me, Rebecca, is my wife will tell me these stories, and I want to go down to the grocery store, and I hope the person is still there. So, I mean, I feel for you. I think in these situations, you want to find basically a polite sarcasm to give people a little bit of a rub back. So there's different things you could say. I mean, you could also take just a complete chipper response and say, "Oh yeah, God has really blessed me, and I hope maybe one day He'll bless you too." You could take if that's within your personality,
that's
you can do it.
Hot coals. That's pouring.
Yeah, pouring hot coals, as St. Paul says. So you can take one route, which is incredible overzealous kindness. And I think that helps because when we're very kind, you know, to others, it makes us feel better. So I think that's probably actually the preferred route. If you're artful at it, you could say things like, some comments I like are, "Oh, well, thank you, but I do want, you know, he's here to pay your Social Security. I wonder who else will."
See, now you're starting to sound like me on the elevator.
Yeah.
With the guy, a little bit.
But I'd give my wife permission to say that. Or I might say, "Well, you know, it's funny you say that because that's strange. You're giving me advice about unwanted children when maybe you could do some work on unwanted advice." Yeah, I guess it's easier. It must be easier to give unwanted advice than to prevent unwanted children, right? You know, so I mean, it depends. But I would say that is a route one should take only very delicately if you feel like you can give a polite rebuke to a person. But I think if you're not sure about what kind of rebuke, you could just respond with overzealous, with kindness, and just to double down, say, "Oh, I am so blessed by these kiddos. I hope you were blessed one day as well." Because you know what? Deep down, when people say that, they'll say, I was watching a video earlier by Chelsea Handler, and she does it on her comedy show, like, kids aren't all that great, and talks about, "Oh, it's great. I can watch 10 hours of Netflix without my kids." But there was an article recently. I forget who did it. I'll look it up here. I know it was a column about it at National Review. But it was dealing with people who... it was about a female sex columnist who has now recently come out to admit she's in her 50s, and she's sad she's childless. You know, that she lived the feminist dream, had a successful career, and now she's sad she's childless. So I think, Rebecca, sometimes when people say this, it's a way of masking the pain that they have at not having children. And so I do think maybe 80% of the time we should respond with just, kindness and wishing blessings upon them and take for granted how grateful we are that their words can't hurt us because God has blessed us with beautiful children and nothing they say can hurt us in that regard. Maybe if you have, if you feel the sense, right, a polite rebuke is in order, but err to kindness when you're not sure. So
what do you think, Rebecca?
How's that?
That helps a lot. Thank you very much. I've heard mothers of large families say things like, oh dear, which one do you think I should give back? But I can't quite use that yet.
Yes, that's Layla's favorite retort. Layla Miller. co-wrote Made This Way with me, and she has 8 children.
Yeah.
I mean, the tolerance level's gotten absurd. There was a time where if you had 8 children, people say, oh, you have your hands full. Which I understand, even with 8 children. To me, I don't even think that's an insult. That's just a statement of...
No, there's nothing wrong
with
that.
You have to monitor. But yeah. Now there are people... My wife will go out with 2 children. You've got your hands full.
Well, she literally does. 2 children will fill 2 hands.
Right, but as if it's unbearable. Or even now with 1 children. But I would also respond to that. Like, that's such a rude comment. Imagine if you said to somebody in a wheelchair, man, stairs must be hard, right? Like, that would be such a rude... awful thing to say, yet people can say this stuff to parents.
Right. Yeah, it's true. People are very negative about baby. Can I tell you a little something? And Rebecca might take interest in this. I don't know. But I knew a man. I worked with him and used to go out to lunch with him. And he had a little 2-year-old who died of seizures. And the thing that bothered him, and I could see it viscerally bothered him when people would complain about children, like any kind of complaint about children, it's not funny. Like, there's people who have lost children. There's people who desperately want children. Right. It's like, if you are tempted to say these negative things, please just stop yourself. That you can really, really hurt people with that stuff. Rebecca, sounds like your kid got a good mom.
Yeah, so keep it up and don't be discouraged. I know how hard it is taking kids to the store. You know, it's like they want to run out of your sight and grab everything, and it's stressful. But so you have 1 child?
Yeah.
How old is your child?
1 so far, yeah. She's almost 16 months.
Oh, I love that. So just remember this in these stressful moments, and this is what I try to remember too. The days are long, but the years are short.
Boy, that's the truth.
And the comments these people make, you're going to forget about it next week, probably. But what you won't forget is how God has blessed you, and pray that He'll bless these other people. Maybe even if it's not with children, but at least with a change of heart. So I hope that's helpful for you.
Yes, that's very helpful. Thank you. Thank you so much for taking my call today.
All right. Oh, my. I hope she doesn't mind. Well, too late. My wife actually just texted me her favorite responses. They include, "I'm not past the rate of replacement yet." We're at 2, so we need .1 children.
Yeah.
And the other one is, well, I got to fill up the minivan I bought to make it worthwhile. I got to fill up that minivan.
That's what Nick's doing. Nick got the minivan with 1, and now he's filling it up.
I'm telling you, with 2, even with 2 children, the minivan with the bucket seats, it is so worth it. Because when you have to bend over in a 4-door sedan to get the kids in, you're back. Like, no, I love the minivan with the power doors. The only thing I want on my minivan is a bumper sticker that says I used to be cool. So, but no, I love the minivan. And guess what? When they're older, the minivan will double as their imaginary spaceship and we will go on adventures.
It is true. Minivans are awesome.
Totally.
Recently, we lost Lee Iacocca, the inventor of the minivan. I hope that comes up in his particular judgment and God gives him credit for...
I hope he does a miracle and he's a patron saint of large families.
Yeah, he should.
Maybe.
Carla Broussard coming up next. We're going to talk about the afterlife. What happens when you go? We'll talk about heaven, hell, purgatory. You don't have to experience all of it. As a matter of fact, some of it you should really try hard not to experience. Trent Horn, you can find him at TrentHornPodcast.com. It's the Council of Trent. You won't be sorry that you did. Thanks very much, Trent. Now go help your wife.
Will do.
Right back with Carla Broussard and what happens after we die, right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Catholic Answers Press is proud to announce the Catholic Answers Classic Edition of G.K. Chesterton's Orthodoxy. Perhaps more than any other book that came from his prolific pen,
orthodoxy exemplifies G.K. Chesterton's style, humor, and singular ability to present ancient truths from a new perspective. Chesterton uses that unique style to offer Christianity as a rollicking adventure filled with beauty, wonder, and peril. Never overbearing or long-winded, Chesterton uses common sense, everyday human experience, and simple but unassailable folk logic to build a case for a Christian view of the universe. Whether you're a die-hard fan of Chesterton's or waiting to be introduced to him, there's no finer edition of orthodoxy to own. Order your copy today by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
For Catholics, history matters. Ours is not a religion based on mythical events. Ours is a religion based on recorded history, in which God has revealed to humanity something about himself and his church through the person of Jesus Christ. In his new book, Handed Down, The Catholic Faith of the Early Christians, author James L. Papandrea offers a fascinating window into the life of the early church and demonstrates that the early Christians were decisively Catholic in how they acted and what they believed. Handed Down is perfect for history-conscious Protestants looking for a friendly defense of Catholic belief, as well as for Catholics who want to deepen their connection with our forefathers in the faith. Order your copy of Handed Down today by calling 1-888-291-8000, going to Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
This is Tim Staples, and I'm here to tell you about a project of mine that I'm really excited about. When Jesus spoke of giving his body and blood for us to eat and drink, it scandalized some of his followers who said, "How can a man give his flesh to eat?" Even to this day, some Christians find Jesus' words to be a stumbling block, to be sure. Most Protestants, in fact, apply a merely symbolic meaning to the New Testament passages that refer to Christ's body. In their attempts to make the Eucharist nothing more than a metaphor, we hear an echo of those gospel skeptics who found the Lord's plain meaning just too incredible to believe. Do you know the Church's teaching on the Eucharist? And more importantly, can you defend those facts with others? In my new audio presentation, Living Bread, A Defense of Christ's Real Presence in the Eucharist, I teach you to do just that, as I break down common objections to the Catholic doctrine of the Eucharist and give you the information you need to defend this essential doctrine from Scripture as well as the teaching and practices of the early Christians. You can get your copy of Living Bread today by calling 888-291-8000. That's 888-291-8000, logging on to Catholic.com or visiting a good Catholic bookstore in your area. It's also available as an MP3.
How can you know for sure that God exists? If God is good, why is there so much evil in the world? Doesn't evolution mean we don't need God to explain human life? Why should I believe in God when religion is the number one cause of war, ignorance, and misery? In 20 Answers Atheism, you'll find smart, solid answers to these questions and many more, helping you to understand the main argument for and against God's existence, and giving you the knowledge you need to explain to others the reasonableness of belief. 20 Answers Atheism is part of the 20 Answers series from Catholic Answers, offering hard facts, powerful arguments, and clear explanations of the most important topics facing the Church and the world, all in a compact, easy-to-read package. Visit shop.catholic.com and take a look at this exciting new series from Catholic Answers Press.
Been waiting for this. It feels good to get to the good part of today's show. Carla Broussard is here. Is that funny to you, Carla? What? This is going to be the good part, right?
What a dig or trip, man.
You oh, I wasn't thinking about that.
Him
no,
around.
I was thinking about you that like this is the good stuff, like heaven, hell, purgatory. This is the stuff I.
So what Trent talked about was not good? Well, I must say I'm flattered to know that you think what I have to say is good.
Yes.
And praise God for that.
And it's definitely better to be with you than Trent. The topic is, as I said, What Lies Beyond. We take that title from Carlo's CD set, Understanding Purgatory, Heaven, and Hell. I got to say, Carlo, I want to start with an objection, kind of.
Okay.
Because I do think that there's the... I don't know. A lot of times I think the whole modern world is built on the question, how could you possibly know that? You know?
Very good. So fundamental question. Yeah.
Yeah. Where do we get our data about the afterlife? Well, you're going to be talking about it for a whole hour. Where do we get any information we have about the afterlife?
Well, ultimately we get it from Jesus. It's a part of Revelation. Okay. So there is one or two or a few things, I wouldn't restrict it to one or two, but a few things we can know about the afterlife by the natural light of human reason, namely that the soul continues to exist upon death.
Okay.
So that's something that we don't need divine revelation to give us knowledge of, although it is a part of divine revelation. But that's something we can come to know philosophically, that the soul is immortal by nature and thus subsists and can continue to exist after death. Beyond that, it's pretty murky waters by the natural light of human reason. You know, would the soul be able to engage in intellectual activity by its own natural powers without the body, apart from divine grace? Philosophers kind of go back and forth on that. Some say, no, it's going to require divine grace and a light of glory in order to exercise its intellectual capacities. Other philosophers might say, no, it would be able to do so even without the body. But it's a lot of gray area concerning exactly what the afterlife would be, what the experience of the soul would be apart from divine revelation. But in divine revelation, with the revelation of the Father through Jesus Christ, we have Jesus revealing to us the reality, ultimately, of heaven and hell. So he reveals to us about the heavenly existence, you know, eternal life he speaks of in John 17:3 is to know you, Father, and the one whom you have sent. So there is a revelation that eternal life is this knowledge of God and of Jesus Christ. In our tradition, we call it the beatific vision, where we will have an intellectual knowledge of the divine essence and what God is. On this side of the veil, we only know God by a concept. It's not immediate. It's mediated through concepts, right? It's not a direct knowledge of what God is. We know that God is by the natural light of human reason. But we don't know what God is in his essence on this side of the veil. We're going to need some help. God's going to have to give us some extra equipment to the mind in order to elevate the intellectual powers, in order to see him face to face as Scripture speaks of it, this beatific vision. And vision is being used there as a metaphor for knowledge, right? Because we even use that in common parlance. You know, when you come to understand something, hopefully you understand what I'm saying, you might say, oh, I see. Right?
Oh, yeah.
We use sight as a metaphor for knowledge. And so and when Scripture speaks of seeing God face to face as that which constitutes heaven, that in our tradition, we understand that to be the knowledge of God's divine essence. So that's what heaven is, this beatific vision from which flows this everlasting beatitude or happiness and satisfaction, because we're united in knowing and possessing, right?
Yeah.
The very infinite good and infinite truth that we naturally long for, that God created us for.
It seems like when Jesus says something, just one sentence like that about to know you and the one whom you sent,
right?
That then that leaves us in the position of applying our reason faculties to that.
To unpack it. And it
unpacks into this.
Right.
It may seem like very little knowledge, but it actually imparts to us a great deal by implication.
That's what we do in theology, right? Yeah. Theology is the application of reason to the deposit of faith, to that which God has revealed to us in order to meditate on it, contemplate it, and unpack it, what those things that Jesus said and the implications of them. That's what we do in theology, and it's been enshrined in the teaching of the church, etc. Now, the counterpart of heaven is obviously hell, right? And that's something else that Jesus teaches in a definitive way in several passages. For example, in Matthew 7, 13 through 15, he talks about entering, enter by the narrow gate, for the gate is wide and the way is easy that leads to destruction. And those who enter by it are many, for the gate is narrow and the way is hard that leads to life. And those who find it are few. So Jesus clearly articulates these two different paths, one to eternal life, one to eternal destruction. One is wide, the way to destruction. One is narrow, the way to eternal life. Many go to destruction, few go to eternal life, right? And there's a big debate about the many and the few. But we have this text here where Jesus clearly teaches there is a state of destruction in the afterlife. And of course, other passages would be like, for example, in that same chapter in Matthew 7, 21 through 23, he says, you know, on the day of judgment, people will say to me, Lord, Lord, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father. On that day, he says, many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name and cast out demons in your name and do many mighty works in your name? And then I will declare to them, Jesus says, I never knew you. Depart from me, you evildoers. So Jesus is teaching us that on the day of judgment, there will be a definitive separation from him with those who are evildoers who ultimately reject him and do not do what he says to do, although they're saying, Lord, Lord, right?
Right.
They're
right.
Not doing the will of the Father and obeying God, and so consequently, they're definitively rejected. And I think ultimately, the key passage is in Matthew 25, 31 through 46, that great passage about the last judgment, the sheep on the right, the goats on the left, the sheep go to eternal life, the goats go to eternal damnation. We have several aspects here revealed. That there is a state of eternal life and damnation is revealed. That there will be some who go to eternal damnation at the end of time is, I would argue, a part of the revelation. Jesus doesn't speak in a hypothetical. If there are goats, they will go to eternal damnation. He says there will be sheep and goats. It's of a prophetic nature, right? And so, and then elsewhere you see also too, like in John 5, Jesus talking about how all of the dead shall rise, right? Both the righteous and the unrighteous. And the righteous shall go to eternal life. The unrighteous shall go to eternal damnation or, you know, eternal torment. And so there you have revelation of how there will be souls in hell at the time of the general resurrection at the end of time.
Yes.
Coming out to receive their bodies and being cast into everlasting torment. So those are a few passages where Jesus reveals to us the reality of hell, which, as the Catechism teaches, is a definitive self-exclusion from God, where a person dies in that final state of choosing something else as their final goal to latch onto for the rest of their existence,
right,
as opposed to God. And that's the epitome of evil, right? To ultimately reject God, the true good, the truth and goodness itself,
right,
for some lesser good or something else.
Nah, I don't want that. I want that's this.
That's right. And attaching to that lesser good. And so you have the epitome of evil because it's ultimately rejecting God.
888-318-7884 is our number. Carla Broussard is our guest. His latest CD set, What Lies Beyond. And I say CD, but it's also, you get a digital download of these things now. I just use the old-fashioned language a lot. Understanding Purgatory, Heaven, and Hell. If you have questions on any of those three, you are welcome to call 888-318-7884. A lot of the July stuff is coming to an end today, so I want to make sure I mention it throughout the hour. The early church fathers, so important to the church, so important to our understanding of Christ's mission here and what he has bequeathed to us. We have a free ebook for you about that. You just go to the main page at shop.catholic.com. And you click on the Early Church Fathers banner, and you download your free copy of Getting Started with the Early Church Fathers. And today's the final day, so that's why I wanted to mention to you again. If you've been thinking about getting it, you got to get it before midnight tonight, Hawaii time. Just go to shop.catholic.com, click on that banner, and you'll get your free ebook, Getting Started with the Early Church Fathers.
join us on air today on Catholic Answers Live.
He was a doctor of the church, a Carmelite, and one of the most famous mystics of all time.
Matthew Bunsen and the Doctors of the Church.
St. John of the Cross wanted to help all Christians to become saints. One of his most important teachings was to encourage us all to learn how to love. For there is no love, he said, put love, and you will find love. He died in 1591.
For more about the Doctors of the Church, visit doctorsofthechurch.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Homeschool Connections, an online provider of courses for your Catholic homeschool, is a sponsor of Catholic Answers Live. Homeschool Connections website is homeschoolconnections.com.
Eye has not seen, ear has not heard. I want to throw that one out at you. I think that's St. Paul.
1 Corinthians 2:9.
And I have heard this objection. Look, it's right there in Scripture. You can't know anything about the afterlife because that's what Paul's saying.
Right. Yeah, this is kind of like another, an extreme, not Paul, but the implication or the interpretation of Paul that is sort of an extreme version of we can't know anything about heaven or anything about the afterlife. You know, some might say we know a lot, you know, we can know everything. You know, people ask for all the details about the afterlife and what's going to happen in the new heaven, the new earth, you know, and food and clothing and all of that.
Right, and dogs.
That's right. But I don't think... what Paul is highlighting there in 1 Corinthians 2:9 is that this is a mystery. There is a lot of darkness, right, when it comes to knowledge about exactly what the reality of heaven and hell and even purgatory will be like. There's a lot of darkness of mystery there, but it doesn't follow from, and that's what Paul is emphasizing, the mysterious element, but it doesn't follow from that there is nothing for us to know about these states of existence in the afterlife. And so we look and we comb through the divine revelation and the deposit of faith and see what glimmers of light we can derive from divine revelation to give us knowledge about these states of existence. And so we look to Scripture, we look to sacred tradition as interpreted by the magisterium of the church. And some of those teachings are going to be dogmatic and infallible. Some of those teachings are going to be what we call ordinary teachings of the church, which is not infallible, but nevertheless the teaching of the church in an ordinary way, which requires religious assent of intellect and will on the part of the faithful, right? Although not infallible, but nevertheless, we believe it, you know, sort of, we believe it as true, understanding that it's not infallible. So there are some things and glimmers of light to know, and some light is better than none. Amen?
Amen.
And think about this too, Si, it doesn't make sense. You know, it's sort of, if we can apply reason, it doesn't really make sense that God would go through the effort of revealing, you know, these realities, okay, reveal that there is a heaven, reveal that there is a hell, and give us no knowledge whatsoever about it. Because, you know, to employ St. Thomas Aquinas here, you know, in the Summa Theologiae, he asks the question, why did God reveal in the first place? And one of the answers he gives is that God has made us for himself, for union with him. So it's fitting that God would reveal himself and that state of existence, some details about heaven to us, in order that we can properly order our lives to that goal.
Oh, yes.
Order our lives, direct our lives to that end, and be motivated to do so.
Yeah.
You don't know anything about the goal or the end to which you're directing your life, you're going to be less inclined to direct your life to that end.
Yeah, I don't know what that is. I don't know.
That's right.
Why should I even want that?
But to have some knowledge of the glory of that end or goal, that's going to inspire us, to move us, to direct our lives to that end goal. So I have a talk that I give at parishes, Heaven, a Destiny Worth Living For. Because, you know, I'm going on here, but Pope Emeritus Benedict XVI in Spes Salvi, his 2007 encyclical, he reflects upon the idea of perhaps maybe there are some who don't want to go to heaven because their idea of heaven is just some mundane day after day boring state of existence that doesn't justify the effort of the journey to make it there.
Right. And if I wanted to play harp, I would have taken harp lessons.
And if I want to look at cute babies, I just make my own babies and look at cute babies, right?
But that's not what it is. It's not just harps and babies.
It is not just that. And so we can talk about some of that stuff in the broadcast here.
We better go to Renee in Lincoln, Nebraska, listening on Spirit Catholic Radio. Renee, your question for Carla Broussard.
Hi.
Renee.
Hi. Thanks for taking me. I'm almost out of my battery, but I heard the topic and I wanted to call in because my kids and I have been trying to wrap our minds around a question about purgatory and why is it that we are asked to pray for the souls in purgatory when presumably they are outside of time? And so how does that work? Or how...
So, Renee, it's a very good question, and there's a couple of ways to approach it. So, first of all, we have to make a distinction that because the state of existence of heaven, hell, and purgatory for human souls, and then ultimately at the end of the time for human beings when the souls get their bodies back, although it is outside of our experience of time, it is not the eternity of God, which is like the eternal now, right? Where all things are simultaneously present to God, past, present, and future. That sort of existence, state of being, right, belongs to God alone. However, the existence or the experience of the souls in the afterlife, although not the eternity of God, is not at the same time our experience of the succession of moments of time and our duration of existence. So the traditional term in classical theology that was used to describe their duration of existence or their existence is what is called aveternity. So it's not God's eternity. It's not our time. It's sort of this in-between middle state of existence. And so it's not our experience, but it is a duration of existence that's not God. So that's about as far as we can go. Now, some speculate about the duration of existence of the souls in purgatory because the church, think about this, Renee, the church has never defined that the duration of their existence is a process or whether it's simultaneous. So theologians go back and forth as to whether the souls experience their final purification immediately, and it's sort of a, you know, sort of a an immediate experience, or whether it's a process. And so there are reasons in both camps to give. So I think you can explain to your kids and say, okay, it's possible that it could be instantaneous. That's what I meant to say a while ago, not spontaneous. It can be instantaneous, or it's possible it could be some form of duration and succession of an experience in the afterlife, but it wouldn't be quite the same as how we experience time in this life. So there is a bit of mystery here as to exactly what the experience of the souls is in the afterlife. So we have to kind of bow in humility to the mystery there, but there are possible explanations as to how that life in purgatory is experienced by the soul.
I don't know if your battery's still working, Renee, but do you think that'll work for you and your kids, that answer?
Yeah, specifically, and I don't even remember what devotion it is, but like I know saints and mystics have received messages like if you pray this prayer or pray this every day, you'll release X number of souls from purgatory.
Right.
So I think that's what started our questioning. Like,
sure, it would seem from the practice of the church in praying for the souls in purgatory, it would seem to favor the idea that their experience of the final purification is not instantaneous, but is some sort of process. But at the same time, it's permitted theological opinion to reflect upon the other answer, that perhaps it is instantaneous from their perspective in the afterlife and successive from our perspective in this life. And even Pope Emeritus Benedict XVI threw this theological idea out in that document I was referring to earlier, Spes Salvi, where he talks about how he highlights that the church has not defined the precise nature of their experience. So theologians speculate as to whether it's instantaneous, or whether it's some sort of process.
I would add a caveat here and ask if Carlo agrees with this. Whenever it comes to private revelation, two things. Oh, one, yeah. There's lots of things that get piled on to what the saint actually said that people added later. So you got to be careful about, is this actually part of something that the saint experienced or said, or is this something that was added on? And even when it comes to particular saints and you know that the saint did say it, you have to remember that's their interpretation, and it has to be taken within the total context of the teaching of the church, and be really cautious about saying, well, a saint saw this vision, therefore that's the teaching of the church. Those are two separate things. Is that fair what I said? Did I say it well
yes,
enough?
Yes, it's okay for us to accept private revelations that are approved, but we also have to exercise discernment and prudence in, as you said, deciphering exactly what is a part of the private revelation, the saint's interpretation of it, etc., and to know that we're not bound to believe private revelation, only public revelation, which is the public, you know, revelation from Jesus Christ and the apostles as taught by the magisterium, definitively taught by the church.
We're talking about What Lies Beyond with Carlo Broussard. Renee, thank you very, very much for your call. Glad the battery held out through that. And I hope that is helpful to you and your kids. Let's go now to Brenda in Ohio, listening on Living Bread Radio. Brenda, your question for Carlo.
Hi, thank you. My question is if Protestants are not taught to believe in purgatory through no fault of their own, are they still held to the same standard for purification of the soul as we are? And if so, how do I explain the origin of purgatory to my Protestant friends?
Right. Yeah, great question, Brenda. Thanks for calling in. So to the question, what's going to happen to the Protestant who is not responsible for his or her ignorance about the dogma of purgatory? How's his judgment going to go? Well, as we know, Brenda, as the church teaches, that God is not going to hold someone accountable for that which they are not responsible. So if their ignorance is due to no fault of their own, then their lack of belief in the doctrine of purgatory is not going to be something that's going to condemn them to hell, right? They're not going to be accountable for not believing. Now, if someone hypothetically were to know it is the truth and to reject that truth, right? Well, then that would constitute a mortal guilt, because that would be grave, serious matter with full knowledge, deliberate consent. But most Protestants don't meet those criteria when it comes to the doctrine of purgatory, often because they have a skewed understanding of purgatory. So they might be rejecting something that the doctrine of purgatory is actually not, right? So concerning their salvation, it's not an absolute necessity that they profess belief in the doctrine of purgatory. In theology, we would say it's a conditional necessity. On condition that the person knows it is true and a part of God's divine revelation, he is bound in conscience to assent to that truth. And if he or she doesn't, well then, hell would be their eternal lot on condition they don't repent. Now, concerning the objective reality, like, will a Protestant or anybody who doesn't know about the doctrine of purgatory or doesn't believe in it undergo a final purification, like in reality, right, before entering into the glory of heaven, if there needs to be a final purification? And the answer to that question is yes. So anybody, whether they believe it or not, if they die in friendship with God, with God's grace, but yet are still imperfectly purified, and have some need of detachment and purification to detach one's heart from created goods, that soul will undergo a final purification before entering into the glory of heaven. And finally, Brenda, the key passage where you want to look to or turn to in conversation with your Protestant friends is 1 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 11 through 15, where St. Paul gives us that teaching on the day, you know, the quality of our works will be manifest. through fire. So the wood, hay, straw, the not so good works, they're going to be burned up. The gold, precious stones, and silver are going to withstand the fire. That's the good works. St. Paul tells us that the individual will suffer loss, but yet will be saved so as through fire. So that's the key text. And go to Catholic.com for more information on that Bible passage.
Brenda, thanks very much for that call. So much more to cover. What lies beyond? We're talking about heaven, hell, and purgatory with Carlo Broussard. Your questions are welcome. 888-318-7884. That's 888-318-7884.
Catholic Answers Live.
In his new audio presentation, The Very First Fathers, apologist Jimmy Akin takes you on a tour of the earliest Christian writings outside the New Testament, from the most famous figures and most notable works to those lesser known but no less important. This pivotal time in the development of the early church is revealed in fascinating detail. Jimmy shows how, even in the first century after the resurrection, it was necessary to defend and explain truths that are still under attack today, such as the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist and the perpetual virginity of Mary. The Very First Fathers is a compelling look at the dawn of the Christian age and edifying listening for anyone who wants to understand and defend the full truth of Catholicism. Order your copy of The Very First Fathers today by calling 1-888-291-8000, logging on to the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Love and beauty. As a little girl, Dawn Eden Goldstein knew she wanted those things, that in them, somehow, she would find God. Over the years, as a rock journalist, she moved among some of popular music's best-known artists, straining to capture that transcendent love and beauty in every note and lyric. In Sunday Will Never Be the Same, Dawn recounts her spiritual journey in beautifully wrought detail, mixing powerful accounts of trauma, healing, and epiphany with funny anecdotes from inside the music scene. It is the rare conversion story that delights as it inspires, amuses as it edifies, and ultimately lays before the reader a lived testimony to the transforming grace of Christ. Order your copy of Sunday Will Never Be the Same by calling 1-888-291-8000, visiting the shop at Catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
I'm Gloria Purvis.
And I'm Deacon Harold. The Morning Glory team talks about being a public witness of our faith.
Tomorrow morning, 7 Eastern. Now back to Catholic Answers Live.
I really love everybody at EWTN. I do. I never get to say that on the air, but there's so many good people at EWTN. And I don't get to go to the radio conference this year. I'm talking to you, Nick. Oh, we're on the air? Oh, sorry. My bad. 888-318-7884 is the number. I really do like the EWTN. I don't regret that we're on the air now, because I really do like all those EWTN people. What Lies Beyond, Understanding Purgatory, Heaven and Hell. That's the new CD set from Carlo Broussard. You can get it now at shop.catholic.com. Oh, as a matter of fact, I didn't really think about this, but since they got the sale on and you can get this as an e-download, you can get this half off until midnight at shop.catholic.com. So I think I just sold some of these for you, Carlo.
Woohoo!
You probably owe me lunch or something.
Mama and the kids are going to be happy, man.
Oh, it's got to give it to the kids. I can't get a little piece of the action. Huh? It's got to go to the kids.
Well, how about you come to the house and then join us at the Broussard Table family, and we'll repay you like that.
I would love to do that.
Indeed.
But you have to allow my wife, Missy, to come, because she thinks your wife, Jacqueline, is the cat's meow. She loves your wife,
Missy's
Jacqueline.
Great.
Yeah, so she can come, right?
Indeed, she can.
Okay, fair enough. John, on YouTube, you are next to your question for Carlo Broussard.
Hey, Carlo. I have a question. What is the beatific vision? When will we achieve it? And is there any biblical hints to this?
Right.
Okay. All right, very succinct and to the point. We appreciate that, John. Yes. So what is the beatific vision? Well, you can check out the Catechism of the Catholic Church to get sort of a succinct summary or a brief synopsis of the definition of the beatific vision in paragraph 1028 in the Catechism of the Catholic Church. It defines it as man's immediate contemplation of God's essence, right, in the heavenly glory, which is called the beatific vision. So that's one place you can go, or what it is. I also, too, John, I like Pope Benedict XII's definition of the beatific vision in Benedictus Deus in 1336. And there are three characteristics, John, that he uses to describe and define the beatific vision concerning this knowledge of God's essence. That's basically what it is, knowledge of God's essence. He defines it as one of the characteristics is intuitive. So that's to say, we're not going to have to reason like we normally do, John, like from one premise to another premise to the conclusion and sort of these successive steps in order to arrive at certain knowledge of things, or looking at Fido the dog and abstracting what we call the form or the essence of dogness and know, hey, that's dogness, and look at that dog over there and say that's a dog too. Notice the discursive or step-by-step process of that normal mode of human knowledge. That's not what our knowledge of God's essence is going to be in the beatific vision. It's going to be intuitive, right? And it's also going to be immediate. So there's going to be direct knowledge of God's essence. We're not going to need any sort of image in our imagination to think about God or know God, nor will we need some sort of concept of God by which we can have knowledge of God. Our knowledge of God is just going to be immediate. God's essence is going to be directly united to our intellect. And Pope Pope Benedict XII also says it's clear, right? So on this side of the veil, our knowledge, we can have some knowledge of God, but it's like St. Paul says in one of his letters, I'm being a bad Catholic here, I can't remember the citation of the Bible.
No, that's a good Catholic.
That's a good Catholic.
You're being a bad Protestant.
Well, you know when Paul in his letter, when he talks about how, you know, we see through
a glass darkened. Yeah, but then we shall see face to face.
That's right. Because on this side of the veil, it's less clear, obviously, but on the other side of the veil, in the beatific vision, our knowledge of God's essence will be clear. And as to the biblical evidence for this, you can check out 1 John 3:2, where John says, "Beloved, we are God's children now. It does not yet appear what we shall be, but we know that when he appears, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is." So notice the metaphor of sight there with regard to our experience of heaven. And so there are other biblical texts as well, but that's one.
Okay. Does that help you, John?
That helps you.
It does.
Thank you so much.
All right, thank you, John.
Yeah, and what's great, what I love about this side, about this, we're not contemplate and think about the beatific vision. You know, the Catechism in paragraph 1024 defines heaven as the definitive, the definitive state of the fulfillment of our deepest human longings, right? In so many words, I think I'm getting it wrong there, but it talks about how heaven is the fulfillment of our deepest human longings. That's definitive and everlasting, right? And which human longings? What's those deep human longings or natural cravings to know, right? To have knowledge, to know the truth, to know what things are, to know reality. Mm-hmm. And when we come to know God's essence, right, our desire for knowledge will be completely satiated, completely satisfied, because there is nothing more to be known, right? God is infinite truth itself, infinite goodness itself. And so the beatific vision is this ultimate source of supreme definitive happiness. That's the language the Catechism uses. I finally got it. Because that craving for knowledge will be completely satisfied in knowing God's essence.
It's not like I'm eating an ice cream and thinking about, oh, this ice cream is going
to
end, what can I do later after I eat this ice cream? Or, you know, like all of that is over. All of the longing, all of the questing, all of that is over, and it's just perfect, pure happiness.
According to my capacity for knowledge, it will be completely maximized, right?
Yeah.
So my capacity for knowledge will be completely maximized according to my finite nature, number one, and also my ability to know, of course, by a created light of glory that God gives the mind to elevate the intellectual powers, but also the will is going to be totally satisfied in possessing.
There's nothing that you want.
There's nothing I'm going to want, because as St. Thomas Aquinas teaches, insofar as there's something left to be desired, we cannot be completely are perfectly happy.
Right.
But when
right.
we come to possess the infinite good, beyond which there is no more good to be desired, our will be completely satisfied.
Yeah.
And so there will be no boredom in heaven. The essence of heaven is total lack of boredom, right? No boredom whatsoever, because there's nothing left to be desired.
It's even better than Netflix.
Amen to that.
Mary, in New York City, watching on YouTube Live, you are up next, Mary. Your question for Carlo.
Hi, thank you very much for taking my call. I have a question for you that I would hope you can explain to me about hell. I'm a lifelong Catholic, and what I get confused about is, although I fully understand that you can only get to heaven through Jesus, and
right.
if you don't believe in Jesus, you can be condemned to hell. But here's where I get confused. For example, if you are a wonderful, wonderful person, just for an example, let's say the Dalai Lama, although it could be anyone,
sure.
who preaches nothing but love, peace, nonviolence. I don't even think he eats meat because of harmfulness to animals. All he does is preach love, be good to one another, etc. And everything I've learned about God and Jesus, they would not condemn someone like him to hell because he's such a wonderful human being, a man of love, a man of peace. However, at the same time, he does not believe in Jesus. And
right.
the Bible is clear. You can only, you're condemned if you don't believe in Jesus. But yet, I have trouble reconciling that. So does
sure.
God, and then I'll be quiet and listen to your answer. But in closing, would God, like, convert someone like that at the last moment? Or is this just one of the mysteries that we'll just never fully understand? Thank you for listening to my question.
Yes, great question, Mary. So you are absolutely correct in saying that no one can enter into the heavenly kingdom except by the grace of Jesus Christ. So whatever grace an individual, whoever it is saved by at the moment of their death, is the grace of Jesus Christ, comes ultimately from Jesus Christ. So there's no other pathway to the Father. As Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life in John 14:6. Now, the question is, okay, well, for a person who doesn't believe in Jesus, can that grace from Christ be communicated to that person outside of the visible boundaries of the Catholic Church and without knowledge of the fullness of the revelation that subsists within the Catholic Church? And the answer is yes, it's possible. And the paragraph in the Catechism, Mary, that you want to check out is paragraph 1260, where it states, quoting Gaudium et Spes from the Second Vatican Council, section 22, and Lumen Gentium, section 16, the Holy Spirit offers to all the possibility of being made partakers in a way known to God of the Paschal mystery. Okay, that's a quote from the Second Vatican Council. Then the Catechism goes on to explain, every man who's ignorant of the gospel of Christ and of his church, but seeks the truth and does the will of God in accordance with his understanding of it, can be saved. Okay, so it's this idea of sort of implicit desire for baptism, right? Had this individual known the fullness of the truth of God's revelation in his son Jesus Christ, that individual would assent to it and embrace it. And so for that particular person who's not responsible for his or her ignorance, right? So they might verbally say, I don't believe in Jesus Christ. They might commit the objective sin against the virtue of religion and deny God's even God's existence, right, within atheism. But we don't have access to the subjective part, right? Full knowledge, deliberate consent. Only God knows the hearts of men, and so only God can judge whether that individual is responsible or not responsible for his or her ignorance of the truth, or even his or her lack of deliberate consent in failing to assent to what is objectively truth. So it's possible. Now, please, Mary, hear me, and for our listeners out there, this does not mean Jesus is irrelevant and anybody can go to heaven without Jesus. That we're not saying that. Any grace by which a person is saved by the grace of Jesus Christ, as you articulated, Mary. Nor are we saying that in order to get to heaven, you just got to be a good person. No. Being a good person is a good thing, and people can be really good people without belief in God, according to the natural moral law. But just following natural virtue is not going to get you to heaven. You need added equipment. You need extra stuff to get to heaven, and it's called grace. And that grace only comes by Jesus Christ. Can Jesus communicate that grace to someone who's outside the visible boundaries and not responsible for their ignorance of Jesus and the fullness of the revelation? Yes. As the Catechism points out elsewhere, we are bound by the sacraments. That is, those to whom the sacraments are revealed and the teachings of Jesus are revealed, we are bound by them. But God is not bound by his sacraments. He can administer his grace outside the visible boundaries of the sacraments, outside of the visible boundaries of membership in the church. What do you think of that, Mary?
Thank you very much. I really appreciate that.
Wait, I just need to, so it is possible for the Dalai Lama to go to heaven then?
Possible, yes.
Okay, good. I just wanted to make sure that.
Now, whether he individually meets those criteria.
That's in God's hands.
That I articulated, that's in God's hands.
Yeah.
Or this person, or that person, or even me as a Catholic, right? I'm inside the visible boundaries of the Catholic Church, but that doesn't necessarily mean that, you know,
You're in communion with Christ.
Right. I could be in the visible boundaries, right? But not invisibly united to Christ if I'm in the state of mortal sin or something, or somebody else, right? So, yeah. So, that's what I would say to that.
Mary, thank you very much. I feel like I want to say something about caddying for the Dalai Lama, but I'm not going to say it. We'll be right back.
Hello, this is Bishop Jeffrey Monfort, Bishop of the Diocese of Steubenville. Make sure you keep it on Catholic Answers Live. God bless you.
Vatican officials will meet to decide the fate of disgraced former Cardinal Theodore McCarrick.
Pro-life leaders applauding the president's strong stand for life.
A new poll finds most Americans, including those identifying as pro-choice, are opposed to late-term abortion.
And Pope Francis says the death penalty is contrary to the gospel.
News headlines you can have faith in. Weekdays at the top of the hour on EWTN Radio.
You've heard that St. Paul Street Evangelization supports hundreds of teams of evangelists sharing the good news. But did you know that some of these teams are public prayer stations? Set up a sign on the sidewalk and offer prayer and encouragement to those you encounter. Everyone needs prayer. Try this new method of witnessing to Jesus. Contact St. Paul Street Evangelization to get started at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. Carlo Broussard, our guest. Our topic, a very important one, what lies beyond understanding purgatory, heaven, and hell? That's the topic of Carlo's new CD set and digital download, however you prefer to get it. And it is a topic of great interest to all of us, frankly. I actually don't know why, like when at Mass or whatever, there's just not more talk about heaven. I feel like people would do better if we just talk about heaven a little bit more. It's real. It's you can go there if you really want to.
Right.
We should talk about it more.
And like I said earlier in the broadcast, it's definitely a destiny worth living for.
Right. Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
I mean, many people, and I think a key element of this is not only to bring in the fact that heaven is the fulfillment of the deepest human longings, the longings of the human heart, as the Catechism points out in paragraph 1024, but also, too, to bring out that aspect of revelation about heaven after the final judgment, namely that we're going to have our glorified bodies back, you know, and what that entails. Obviously, there's mystery there, but there are some things that we do know, as St. Paul teaches us in 1 Corinthians 15. We will be in a state of glory, like Christ in his resurrection, right? We will be in a state of incorruptibility, where the body will no longer suffer nor die.
Yeah.
And we're going to be in a state of, you know, St. Thomas Aquinas reflects upon other characteristics that flow from what we see revealed in Jesus Christ, because Paul tells us, 1 Corinthians 15:49, we will image the heavenly man. Well, Jesus was like appearing and disappearing, right? The doors were locked, and he walks through those doors is in their presence, right? So that's the gift of the ability to pass through, not be bound by matter and spatial locations.
It's very subtle.
Also, the gift of agility, mm-hmm. the swiftness to be able to be from one location to another, which looks like we're appearing and disappearing, but it's because it's so swift, right?
Yeah.
The gift of agility. I mean, these are characteristics of the glorified body that we have present in divine revelation and in the tradition of the church as we reflect upon that divine revelation, which I think can inspire people and say, yeah, I want that. And then, of course, contrast that with the bodies that the unjust will get and the experience of the torments of hell as well.
Yeah.
Because that is not something we want.
I always laugh when you say about having our bodies restored to us, because I feel like my soul will be like, no, don't put me back in there. And your soul will be like, yeah, get me back in there.
I don't know.
I've been flexing. My soul's going to be like, please, I'm fine where I am. Why do I have to go back in there? Chris in Harrisburg, Virginia, listening on the EWTN app. You are up next. What is your question, Chris, for Carla Broussard?
Thanks, guys. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can. Yeah, go ahead.
All right, sorry about that. I'm interested to find out or understand better justification by faith as outlined by Paul and justification by works according to James. Both seem incredibly clear and direct, but it's kind of got me confounded.
Yeah. Okay. All right, so, Chris, when Paul talks about justification apart from works of law, right? For example, in Romans 3:28, we're justified by faith, not by the works of the law. The common understanding of works of the law refers to the Mosaic law of the Old Testament. And all of those precepts that were abrogated with the advent of Christ, not the precepts that belong to the natural moral law and which were affirmed by Christ in the new law, but all of pretty much the ceremonial precepts has been abrogated, and we're no longer justified by adhering to those precepts which belong to a particular group of people, namely the Jews. The standard, or that by which we are justified in the new covenant, is that which applies to all people, Jews and Gentiles, and that is faith in Jesus Christ. And that initial, and it's important to point out, that the initial grace of justification, that movement of the Holy Spirit that gets us in the direction pointing us toward our final goal, namely union with God, is entirely unmerited. That initial grace of conversion, as the Catechism puts it in paragraph 2010, no one can merit the initial grace of forgiveness and justification, as it states. Now, once we're put into that movement, once that initial grace is given to us, on condition that we do not reject it, on condition that we do not refuse it, that grace will accomplish its goal. It will lead us to have faith, and given the revelation, given our knowledge of the revelation of Jesus, that we are to be born again by water and spirit, we approach the waters of baptism, of course, in ordinary circumstances when we're not impeded from it, right? And through that water and spirit, we were born again or born anew. According to St. Paul in Romans 6, 3 through 4, we die with Christ in this baptism, and we rise with Christ to a newness of life. And in verse 7, we are freed from sin. The Greek word there is dikaiou, which is justified. We're justified from sin. So through baptism, according to the mind of St. Paul, we are justified. In St. Peter's letter, first letter in 1 Peter 3:21, he tells us that baptism saves us. So that initial grace of justification is entirely unmerited. And on condition we don't refuse it, it's going to accomplish its goal, moving us to faith in Christ, which who tells us to be born anew by water and spirit. Now, James, in James 2:24, when he says we are not justified by faith alone, but by works, right? And he uses Abraham offering Isaac in obedience to God's command as an example of justification in works. It's interesting to point out, Chris, that the Council of Trent references that passage of James, it references it in with regard to increasing in righteousness or justice or our rectitude of order, the rectitude of order of our will to God, right? To increase in charity, to increase in love, to increase in justice, to increase in righteousness. That's when works come into play. And not only to increase that relationship with God, to strengthen it, to increase our right orderedness to God, right? But also to preserve our righteousness in our relationship with God. So works don't come into play concerning that initial movement of grace pointing us in the right direction, that initial grace of justification and forgiveness. Works come into play after we enter into Christ and we are in relationship with Christ, a member of the mystical body. Therein is where the works that James speaks of, as interpreted by the tradition of the church, where works play a role in increasing our righteousness and preserving our righteousness and charity. And then, of course, works do come into play at the end of time, as St. Paul says in Romans 2, that we will be judged according to our works. Those who have done good in the body, to eternal life. Those who have done bad, to eternal damnation. So works do also play a role for that final dimension of salvation and or justification. What do you think of that, Chris?
It makes sense. I guess I'm still a little torn on when James says, you know, show me your faith and I'll show you my works. And almost in a way that, you know, your faith is worthless. I mean, when I read that, I'm sure it's not that way, but it feels that way when I read it.
Well, no, you're right on track, Chris, because what James is referring to is once we're in Christ and we have faith in Christ, that faith, in order for it to be salvific, in other words, in order for it to be pleasing to God, which is what's necessary to be saved, right? Ultimately, at the end of time, to enter into union with Him in heaven, it's going to have to be animated by charity. It's going to have to, that faith is going to have to include charity. As St. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 13, faith, hope, and charity. And that charity, it must manifest itself in our behavior and in our lifestyle and the way we order our lives, because that charity is what's going to properly order our lives to our ultimate goal of union with God. If we're lacking that charity, we're going to be in the other direction. And no matter how much belief we have in God, it ain't going to save us if our heart is not ordered to God.
Chris, I'm going to say thanks because I want to get to as many calls as I can this hour with Carlo. We'll go to Evelyn in Ohio, listening on The Rock, which is in Cleveland, Ohio. And Bernadette Bogowski is the person who runs it there. And whenever I get a call from The Rock, I always want to say hi to Bernadette. So hi, Bernadette. And let's go to Evelyn. Evelyn, your question for Carlo.
Hi, Carl.
Hi, Evelyn. Thanks for calling.
My question is, Hi. My question is about purgatory. Will you be able to know that you're in purgatory, do you think, as opposed to being in hell?
The answer is yes. Yes. The individual soul will have knowledge of their eternal destiny. That's given to us at our particular judgment. That judgment, we call it the particular judgment, which is the judgment the soul receives, the moments after death, right? Or upon death, or at after death, because Hebrews 9:27 is appointed to every man to die once, and then the judgment. 2 Corinthians 5:8, we all stand before the judgment seat of Christ, right? So at that judgment after death, immediately, the soul receives its destiny, whether heaven or hell. If its destiny, its eternal lot, is heaven, well, then that soul, if need be, will go through a final purification before entering into the glory of heaven. So the soul will have awareness, by the grace of God, not only of its eternal destiny, heaven or hell, but also if that soul is in its state of final purification. If the soul goes immediately to hell, the soul will know it is in hell, because one of the pains, right, the primary and chief pain of hell, as the Catechism points out, is loss of the beatific vision, right? The absence of being, of knowing and being united to God is the chief and primary pain of hell. And so in order to experience that quote-unquote pain, right, we're talking about the pain of the soul, not pain of sense here, because the soul doesn't have its body yet, that pain that the soul experiences, it wouldn't be able to have that suffering, experience that form of suffering, if it didn't have knowledge that it was separated from God, right? So the soul would have knowledge or awareness that it is indeed definitively separated from God, and that's the chief and primary pain of hell.
Thanks, Evelyn in Ohio. Thanks to everybody who called. Sorry to those callers I couldn't get to, but as we guessed, this is a very popular topic. We'll have to have you on to do it again, because
amen,
a lot
of
more people wanted to ask you questions.
Fun stuff.
Carlo Broussard has been our guest. This CD set we've been talking about, What Lies Beyond, Understanding Purgatory, Heaven, and Hell. It's available now. As a matter of fact, if you get the e-download of it, it's half price till midnight at shop.catholic.com. Carlo is also the author of Prepare the Way, Overcoming Obstacles to God, the gospel, and the church, you should get that book. And what was the talk you said you give? Heaven, it's a place worth living for?
Heaven, a destiny worth living for.
A destiny worth living for. If you want Carlo to come give that talk at your parish, find him at CatholicAnswersSpeakers.com. 2 hours of open forum tomorrow. We'll see you then, God willing, on Catholic Answers Live.